Morning Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And as always, when I say we, it's not just me. It's me and my very, very knowledgeable and well-known automotive journalist located in the film strip below. Excuse me for fumbling through that again. Many times that I've said it, you'd think I'd have it down by now. But that's just not the case. As usual, I have the journalists introduce themselves. We're a couple of people shy today, for one's at an event and one is under the weather. But other than that, everybody else is here. I'll let you let them say a little bit about where they are, who they are, and what they do. Ron.
Hi there, Ron Moorhead, coming from Northern California above San Francisco. It's nice and cloudy here. I'm the editor of AutoReviewsPlus.com. I contribute to a large newspaper syndication and work for a lot of different websites and print. I've been in the auto industry since I got out of college, which was a long time ago. And editorial comment, Delta Airlines suck.
The expression.
Not Delta.
What did I say? The opinions that you hear. not
necessarily yours.
Not necessarily those of Auto Network Reports. That was Ron Moorhead.
Hey, Ron Moorhead.
Russ.
Well, with our ladies absent today, I feel like I'm here for a meeting of the He-Man Woman Haters Club. But that's all right. Coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina, I'm Russ Heaps, and I've been covering the auto industry for, 25, 30 years or so. I've done it in print. I've done it for newspapers, magazines. Currently, I'm doing a lot of stuff for Bankrate.com and Autotrader.com. I also honcho a little website called Greenville Insider, which is a deeper dive into Greenville, South Carolina.
Yeah, and check out the Greenville website. Greenville is a nice city to visit, and if you go there through Russ's site, you can find out where to go, what to see, who to talk to, and maybe who not to talk to. Knowing Russ, I know one thing, you know all the bars. You'll know all the bars in Greenville. If you're a beer drinker, you know all the beer joints.
I do have a kind of narrow focus of expertise, I'll have to say.
Right. Beer and women. Greg.
Good afternoon. I'm Greg Morrison. I'm executive producer and owner of Bumper to Bumper TV, a weekly video report on trends and reviews and products in the auto industry. Like Russ and Ron, I've been covering this for a few minutes, not quite as long as Ron, but almost the same amount of time as Russ. I'm in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm here to testify on Russ's behalf that he's a connoisseur of good beer. He's not a drunkard. He's not a wino. He's a connoisseur of good beer.
Frank.
I don't know, Russ. I'd get my lawyer if I were you.
All that name calling.
Anyway, I'm Frank Washington. I'm based in Detroit, still the psychological heart of the auto industry. We have a balmy 65 degrees today, which is great because tomorrow it could be 35. That's the way. That's how the weather in Michigan goes. Anyway, I've been covering the industry for a number of years, ever since I first arrived here in 1988. And the bureau chief at the time at the magazine I was working for basically told me to cover the industry because she didn't want to be bothered with them because she thought all the executives were a bunch of sexist pigs, so you do it. So I said, okay, and walked out of her office. Anyway, I do a syndicated column now called AboutThatCar.com, which is distributed to several hundred black newspapers across the country. I also have a website of that same name, as well as do a lot of posting to social media sites, certainly Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, and then Google as well. I'm currently working on a book about blacks in the auto industry. And as I said, I hope to be done with this in an hour so I can go outside.
Well, we may not even go an hour, Frank, so you can get that extra vitamin D.
Okay.
Frank mentioned Facebook. We are now streaming live on Facebook. If you go to any of our Facebook pages, you can watch the broadcast from there. You can watch it, obviously, if you're watching on YouTube, you can watch it on YouTube. But now we're expanding to post it on Facebook. And eventually, we will be able to actually live stream the show to Facebook. I had a conversation with the owner of the technology that we use for Business Hangouts on Air. And one of the things that they're starting to consider is to, since Facebook has the open API where developers can write code so that you can broadcast to Facebook from different locations, different types of cameras and setup. And he's seriously considering having it where Business Hangouts will have a feed directly into Facebook Live, which would make my life and all of our lives a little easier. We don't have to worry about dropping embed code in any place. So we'll see what happens with that. Okay, what are we driving today? Well, before we get into that, this is my one-year anniversary for carcinoid tumor surgery that I had May 5th, 2015. And I'm not going to talk about what carcinoid tumors are, but I had 23 of them. And they were found because, you've probably heard me say this, prostate cancer saved my life. They were found because I had prostate cancer. My doctor decided, after watching my PSA for a while, that maybe we need to do a lower body scan. Did a lower body scan. Little bitty white spot showed up on the scan, and he said that's possibly a carcinoid tumor. So I said, you mean to tell me now I have two cancers? He said yes. I said, okay, which one do we attack first? He said, I think I should go in and do some exploratory for the carcinoid. 6 hours later and 23 tumors removed later, he made the right choice. And that's the name of that story. So I'm still here. I had 39 radiation treatments for the prostate, which the last one was on January the 6th. So pretty soon I'll have another anniversary coming up. But all I can say is, if you are, especially black males, please, 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 go in, get your PSA checked. It's painless, draw a little blood. It will make the difference in whether you are here today or how your life will be spent for the next 5 to 10 years. I think I'm going to end up doing a show on it on a regular basis, not a part of this show, but a different show to talk about it. Because I found when I was sitting in the radiation waiting room, you know, you get to meet other people, especially I'm in there with other men. And I was amazed at how many of the guys that were in there did not want any of their family members to know that they had prostate cancer and that they were getting radiation treatment, which I think after talking to some other people that I ended up finding out that had prostate cancer as well, that they didn't talk about it. If you happen to ask somebody, they might say yes, but it's primarily hereditary. I'm not a physician, but I knew that eventually I was going to get it because every male on my dad's side that was alive had it. His younger brother had it, finished his treatment about five or six months ago. But anyway, that's enough on that. Okay, what are you guys driving this week? Ron?
I have a Volkswagen CC sedan.
Ooh, I like that car.
Very luxurious vehicle and fun car. I just picked it up, so I haven't gone over the pricing or anything like that, so okay. I'm a little remiss in my information. But
well, that's okay. What did you have before that?
Oh, my God, what did I have before that? No. I had the Range Rover TD6 diesel.
Oh, that's right. You talked about that last week.
I did.
Okay.
And fabulous vehicle as well. And the CC, I'll hopefully be able to talk a little bit next week. But
that's okay.
We all know Volkswagen makes wonderful automobiles.
Yeah, we don't need all the details. I don't want you to put your story out on AutoNetwork reports. What else? What are you driving this week?
I've got a 2016 Hyundai Veloster. It's the Rally Edition, so it's that matte blue paint finish on it, which I really like. I wouldn't want to own one because they're really a pain to take care of the paint job. It's a little more work than a regular paint job, but I love the way they look. And it's got a 1.6 liter turbocharged engine, 201 horsepower, 6-speed manual transmission. It's fun to drive. It has a terrific exhaust note. It's got a sporty interior, nice leather seats with contrasting trim on them. It looks good. It's comfortable, and it's with the freight and everything. It's $24,775. I'm telling you, for that amount of money, I think it's a pretty good deal. I don't know. I would still probably, if faced with spending that kind of money on something, I would look again at the Mazda Miata, which I love a lot, and can be had in that same price range. But yeah, I love this car. It's a lot of fun.
And that's a strange looking automobile.
Yeah, and if I heard it correctly, and I should have looked it up before the show today, since I knew I'd be talking about it. But I think Hyundai's discontinuing this nameplate. Have you guys heard that? Or am I wrong about that?
No, I haven't heard that.
I haven't heard anything about that.
Okay, so maybe I'm wrong.
We're not the most knowledgeable.
Don't take that to the bank.
Yeah, we're the experts, but not the most knowledgeable. So.
No, but we can spread rumor just like the best of them.
Oh, yeah. Got that right. Okay, Greg, what are you driving this week?
This week I got a chance to have a repeat, so to speak. I got a second look at the 2017 Kia Sportage, the SXT version. It comes with a 2-liter turbo that kicks out about 240, 250 horsepower, which is a lot considering it's a 4-cylinder engine. A lot of fun, very roomy. Even the back seat is comfortable for adults to get into and out of it. As you know, we've all talked about the challenges with the back seats of the SUVs and crossovers with no footwell space. This one manages to deal with that. And fully loaded, this one is about $32,000, but I mean, that's everything including the kitchen sink. The only thing it didn't have was all-wheel drive, which, you know, has good points and down points. So we'll be posting that review later this week.
Great. Frank?
Hi. I just got out of the Toyota Prius yesterday. I swapped that for a Hyundai Elantra, but I'll talk about the Prius since I just got into the Elantra yesterday. But anyway... I was very impressed with the Prius. It had an average or a fuel rating. Excuse me, my mind is someplace else. They had an average fuel rating.
Get it back on the show, man. I only want another 45 minutes of your time.
Well, see, now you're breaking my train of thought again.
You want to get outside, yeah, don't you?
Yeah, I'm trying to hurry up, if you'd let me.
Go ahead, Frank.
Anyway, it had an average fuel economy of 52 miles per gallon, which I thought was great. I had the car for a week. It wasn't like I was doing a lot of driving, you know, to faraway places. But still, I used barely a quarter tank of gasoline, which I found really impressive. The car was extremely quiet, even for a Toyota, even for a hybrid. Even when the gasoline engine kicked in, you could barely hear it, or at least I couldn't. I was even more impressed with the CVT. That's the transmission on this particular car, because again, it was quiet, and it didn't have that strain of that continuous strain that CVTs normally have under, particularly when they accelerate. I thought the utility of the vehicle was great, because as we know, and as the public should know, when you're talking about a Prius, you're basically talking about a hatchback. In terms of, at least I had the Prius C. I had managed to get a huge piece of furniture. When I say huge, I'm talking about a console that was about 60 inches long, 25-30 inches wide, 25-30 inches high. And I folded down the front passenger seat and was able to, not by myself, of course, but I was able to slide that piece of that piece of furniture in and close the hatch, which I was very impressed with. The only thing that, as I told somebody, that I had a problem with was that the front seat didn't fold me down. You kind of folded maybe a third of the way, and that was it. But you know, for $29,000, because that's what the car was, $29,842, I believe. It was a nice vehicle. It was a very nice vehicle, very impressive.
You starting a moving company, Frank?
Well, you know, when you run across a deal, you gotta take it.
You got it.
Well, my car for this week is the 2016 Infiniti QX80. It has a 5.6 liter V8, a V8, folks, all-wheel drive, limited, 400 horsepower at 413 pound-feet of torque, 7-speed automatic transmission. Exterior color is a Hermosa blue. Interior is graphite. Gets 13 miles per gallon in the city, 19 on the highway, and 15 combined. And if you have a cool $89,845, you can own this particular model. First thoughts, Russ.
This just showed up in my driveway today.
What?
Yeah, in fact, it's casting a shadow over half my backyard. It is.
Hold your thoughts. I didn't give my first thoughts.
I haven't driven it yet. They picked up the Veloster and dropped this off.
I would consider this could be your man cave. This thing has everything in it. It has two video screens, one on each front headrest. It has, I forgot how many speakers, but a great sound system. The seats can fold down, and they do fold down flat, so you can lay in there, and if you choose to put a pallet or something in, or you know, inflatable bed or something, you can lay in there and watch television or watch your movies, and nobody would even know you're in there, so it could be your man cave. But this thing is huge. It is one huge automobile. The other thing is, it's like sitting in your living room because the seats are big. They're extremely comfortable. And the power, 400 horsepower, later on, I don't know whether we get to the sound in the video, but I normally do a standing start and just press the accelerator to the floor just to see what it'll do and what it'll sound like. This thing will get out of its way quickly. It'll pin you to the seat as big as it is. But anyway, go ahead, Russ.
Is it my turn to talk now?
Yeah, go ahead.
Wow. You're way harsh, Roosevelt.
Yeah,
all right, Frank, it's your turn.
Yes. I like the looks of it. I guess if you want something this big, it's wonderful. Sadly for me, this is the vehicle I'll be driving over to Nashville next week, the beginning of the week. I'm not thrilled with the whole 13, 14 miles per gallon thing. I didn't realize it was quite that, that's where the mileage was on it. But anyway, I think it's a terrific looking vehicle. I like Infinities. Would I spend $90,000 on this one? Probably not, simply because it's just something that I don't need. And let me just say, while you guys were talking earlier and I was so rudely interrupted and had found myself with some time on my hands, I jumped on and looked up the Velociter, and I guess there have been rumors swirling around for the last year and a half that it was going to be discontinued, but I couldn't find anything that said yes for sure or no for sure. So as far as I know, that's just a nasty rumor. Carry on.
That we're perpetuating. Ron, first thoughts.
Well, this Infiniti is very well appointed. It's wonderfully trimmed. It's an attractive vehicle. It is huge, no doubt about that. Nissan is having an issue with their fuel economy in some of their vehicles. You know, they're kind of getting hit for that, and it is a little low compared to what some of the other major manufacturers and their large SUVs. This Infiniti is really well laid out. It's an attractive vehicle. It's a nice vehicle, but again, like Russ said, $90,000. Take into account, we are auto journalists, so we don't go out and spend $90,000 on a vehicle generally. But it's a good vehicle for what it has.
If it had a panoramic sunroof, I would have bought one.
Would you? Yeah. And an airbed in the back, because you'd have to sell your house.
No, just a panoramic sunroof. That little bitty sunroof that it has in this big car, it just looks out of place. Greg, first thoughts.
Well, when you described what the space capabilities are, it reminded me of what my friends used to do with a van in the 70s, only they weren't watching TV in the back. But that said, beautiful car, beautiful appointment. And, you know, obviously it's a very capable vehicle for what you're getting. But we all have to remember, people who are spending $89,000, $90,000 don't care about fuel economy. So that's a minor thing for this segment. This is a very niche vehicle for the ultra-rich who want luxury, who want some of the technology, and also want performance. So, you know, you put it up there with the Range Rovers and some of the Land Rovers in that terms. Will Infiniti sell 300,000 of these in a year? I seriously doubt it. But the folks who do buy them will be very, very happy.
Frank, first thoughts.
I agree with it, what everyone has said. I remember some time ago I had one of these, perhaps not this particular model, but I had one. And, again, very spacious, cavernous, actually, inside, well-appointed. I think we said before that Infiniti really doesn't get the credit it deserves for producing some great vehicles, and as good as the vehicles are, I think their interiors are even better. They do a really, really good job. One of the things that nobody mentioned that struck me was, you know, you're talking about a vehicle that's about $90,000, you know, you're up close to six figures, and now you've got a number of ultra-luxury automakers coming to market with SUVs. Bentley comes to mind first and foremost. And, you know, I think it's Bentley, is it Maserati or Lamborghini, or maybe both of them. I just can't remember. So, you know, as pricey as this vehicle is, there's competition coming, very stiff competition. You know, as you say, it's a vehicle, you know, Greg, as you said, it's a vehicle for the wealthy or those who think they're wealthy. The question becomes, we've posed it before with certain vehicles, you know, if you've got $100,000 to spend on an SUV that you probably don't need, but, you know, you've got $100,000, what are you going to spend it on, a Bentley or an Infiniti? And therein lies the, trouble on the horizon for not only Infiniti, Cadillac, Lexus, in terms of these manufacturers of large SUVs. There's vehicles coming from luxury manufacturers who have far more brand recognition in this particular segment than any of those vehicles. Just a thought.
Just a thought. That was a good thought, Frank. We appreciate that.
Well, I'm glad you approved.
You know, we have a celebrity that, even though, what did I do? Here I go again. I lost the page. We have a celebrity with us, even though we're all celebrities in our minds, and by being on the show, you have to be a celebrity to even be invited. But we have one that's gone way and beyond. He's international, and he's proven that he's international. He's actually been interviewed by the Chinese. Greg, tell us how that came about and what you said for them. What kind of content did they want? And when did you learn to speak Chinese?
Well, first of all, thank God they have an English language service. Because all I can say in Chinese is xie xie, which means thank you. Back in December, I had a chance to go to China for 11 days. And one of our colleagues, Brian Armstead, was also on the trip. They were looking for journalists to show off China to. And part of the trip was a visit to some auto plants. And also to China Radio International. And when you go to Asia, one of the things I've learned, and we're all aware of this, is that you present your name card, your business card. And we had a great conversation with the folks at a couple of places, and China Radio International reached out to me to comment about some of the trends that they were seeing at the Beijing Auto Show. We also touched on autonomous driving vehicles and alternative driving vehicles. And Russ, even the Chinese are curious about one of your favorite areas, which is hydrogen vehicles. So it was one of those conversations that started, you know, simply because I happened to be in the right place at the right time. Thank God the discussion was in English. The only downside was that the interview took place at 10 p.m. in the East, 10 p.m. Eastern time, because that was 10 o'clock in the morning in Beijing. But other than that, it was fun. We talked about a lot of things. They are very curious about what gets people excited in the U.S. in terms of vehicles, especially in the terms of autonomous and connected cars. And they are admitting that they have a couple of problems there. One, traffic. Two, Chinese drivers are just learning how to handle cars. So there's a whole culture of how do you behave on a highway and not kill each other.
Well, great, Greg. I'm glad you had the opportunity and much, much success. And hopefully they'll call you back on a regular basis, because you just, as we're finding out on this show, you're just full of knowledge.
I'm not sure that the fact that the conversation was in English was a big advantage to you, but that's just my thing.
Well, at least I know when they're talking about me badly.
That Atlantaese sounds like China. Sounds like Chinese.
Bostonian.
Okay, moving right along. It seems like Takarta just will not go away. They have announced that there will be an additional, listen to this, an additional 30 to 40 million vehicles on the road with the Takarta igniter problem. Can you believe that?
And that's in addition to the 29 million,
right,
or however many that they already, yeah.
Why don't they just come out and say all the cars that we ever put a Takarta airbag in has the problem? And it's starting to strike here home in Charlotte. Last night on the news, they parked EMS vehicles because of the Takarta airbag situation. Now, you can't have emergency vehicles parked on the side of the road not being able to go out and assist people when there is a medical emergency. But it's now starting to really hit home, like I said, here in Charlotte, where on the news they parked the vehicles. And I don't know what they're going to do, because if they can't get parts, and that seems to be the issue with the bags right now, is getting the parts for the dealers to be able to, to make the replacements. So it's going to be interesting to see how they handle that and whether that's going to happen across the country.
Well, what I'm kind of surprised about is that our federal government hasn't come into play and said, okay, Takarta, get somebody else to manufacture these so we can get them built and get these vehicles safely on the road. Some other sort of manufacturing agreement.
I don't know how you do that, though. I mean, how do you do? Even if Takarta was a U.S. company, there, you know, how do you? You can't just create that manufacturing. You've got to have that. You've got to have that in place. And I don't know whether there are competitors.
Well, mostly inflate. From what I understand, and I'm not an engineer, obviously. You guys know that. Excuse me, but most of the inflators, which Frank will tell us that's the issue, it's not their igniters, it's not the airbag, most of those are somewhat universally manufactured, from what I understand. But, I don't know. You would think that that's upwards towards 70 million vehicles?
Yep.
And if they corrected the problem today, they could not produce enough parts to fix all those cars for the next probably 10 years.
10 years, yeah.
I mean, it's unbelievable the magnitude and the scope of this problem. And people don't seem to be concerned about the issue. I don't know whether they're waiting around for their bag to go off. Hopefully they don't get killed and they can sue and make some money. But that's like playing Russian roulette. I wouldn't want to chance that with my family in the car. But there seems there's not enough uproar from consumers to kind of push this thing along, like Ron was saying, the federal government getting involved.
You know, in my view, I still think, you know, yes, it's a problem, but I think basically what it is that it's not right there in front of you where you can see it, touch it, and feel it, you know.
It will be if your airbag goes off.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that's the point. You know, the point. You know, until that airbag goes off, it's not a problem. And then when the airbag goes off, there's no, I hate to use the word, guarantee that it's going to misfire. And you're going to be injured, you know, in terms of this problem. But you know, it is a problem. But basically, what I'm doing is that I'm trying to address what Roosevelt's comment was. There's no uproar because you know it's not seen, it's not heard. There's no immediate threat. It's not like they're saying that you know there's a forest fire and you look out the window and your backyard's ablaze, you know. So I think that's part of the problem. The second thing, because of the magnitude of the problem, there are going to be a lot of cars riding around with defective airbags for their lifespans, because I just don't see all of these vehicles being fixed in the next 2, 3, or 4 years, if not longer. So basically what we're going to be faced with and what Takata is going to be faced with is the liability adjacent with these defective airbags because they've got to take a write-off to get them fixed. You know, so I can't imagine how much that's going to be, you know, and then they face the liability of folks being injured because they didn't have enough parts to make the repair.
Go ahead, Ron.
Frank, you brought up a very good point that our listeners and consumers should realize. The real defect is on a very small percentage of these inflators, but they're recalling all of them back because of the manufacturing run. So, yeah, you're right. Maybe that's what's slowing things down because a lot of consumers are saying, well, I'm taking a chance that maybe mine's not defective.
Yeah.
I don't think enough consumers even are aware of the problem. And Frank, you're talking about it's not right in your face or something like that. It's sitting there right in your face. You are sitting in front of a time bomb that's sitting in the middle of your steering wheel as a driver. Every time you get in the car, that bomb is still sitting there. Now, it may not go off today. It may not go off tomorrow. It may not ever go off.
Did we lose him?
But wouldn't you want to have the peace of mind that is not even there to even be concerned about?
Well, yeah, I'm going to try to put some perspective on this. When this story about Takata broke, I was still working in my other job at CNN, and I remember seeing the initial bulletins about it and running over to the national desk and the international desk and saying, hey, guys, this is going to be a big story. We need to do something. And they went, it's just a part in the car. No one cares about it. I think part of the challenge for something that's this serious is, you know, we're the automotive press. We talk about this. We're jumping up and down and screaming about it. But there are too many people out there who are consuming information that doesn't come from people like us. They're getting whatever they get off of Facebook or off of whatever source they're getting. And mainstream media is spending more time worrying about who's got bad hair or who's dating whom or who's breaking up with whom, then telling people, by the way, you're sitting behind a time bomb every time you get behind the wheel. So that's a big part of the issue why there's no uproar about this issue. I'm surprised that Charlotte EMS or Mecklenburg County EMS took the step that they did at this point. This has not been a secret for several years. So my question is, when this first became apparent, why they didn't rotate those vehicles out of service and get them repaired as emergency service vehicles, they should get priority in getting this issue repaired and addressed. So, you know, a lot of questions there. It's like, is this a political play? Is this an election year in Charlotte and someone's trying to make points? What? We've known about this going on 6 years now. 6 years. And you're telling me that all of a sudden they decided, well, we're going to pull our EMS units off the streets? What about fire engines? Well, not fire engines, excuse me, police vehicles. You know, those other vehicles that are also saddled with them. Come on, guys. Nice political grandstanding, but you knew about this a while back. Why you didn't get your vehicles in, especially as first responders, to get it addressed on a priority basis, I have no idea.
Well, there are a lot of questions that we probably will never really get the answers to. But anyway, moving right along, talking about staying with recalls, Nissan is recalling 3.5 million cars in the U.S. for the passenger side airbag sensors and a deformed seat belt bracket that could shut off, that could come off or break off and affect the airbag system. It's in the 2013-2017 models. If the replacement is, again, a software and some hardware fixes. That's the side airbags. Okay, Jaguar Land Rover. Here we go. How many of you jump in the car, drive away, and you find out that you left your cell phone, you left your suitcase or whatever it was, you left your book bag at home and you don't really want to turn around? Jaguar Land Rover says that they have a fix. It's called the Tile. It's a Bluetooth device to locate items that you may forget before leaving home. And it ties into with their infotainment system, so you can set up a list. Obviously, you have to buy these little Tile devices, and you attach them to the things on your list that you want to make sure that you have in your car before you pull away. Now, all of us on this panel need something like that, as old as we are. But they seem to be targeting the younger generation by tying this into the infotainment system pretty much for them to use this Tile.
This might be the California edition. You know, there's so much smoke floating around these folks' heads, they can forget everything.
And it sounds like a bad case of sometimers at a very early stage.
I mean, I'm sure that they gave a lot of thought to this and put, you know, many, many, many months of engineering brain power into this. But couldn't you just make a list?
You know,
I've got a basket by the front door where I put my car keys, my phone, and I keep my briefcase right there.
Go ahead, Russ.
I was just going to say, I don't know whether they still have it, because it's been a while since I've had a lot of contact with Ford. But at one point on the F-150, they had a computer program built in where you could keep track of the tools in your tool chest. And if some tool wasn't in your tool chest when you started driving away, it would alert you to that. I don't know whether that's still something that they offer or not. I think it's an okay idea. You know, you could scotch tape one to your baby, or you know, whatever it is that you needed to take with you. But you know, what are they going to sell those tiles for? How much is it going to cost? I mean, we're talking Jaguar and Land Rover, for the love of God. It's going to be, you know, these are going to be expensive little things. Who cares? If somebody has that much money and they need help remembering stuff,
hire an assistant.
I can see the first thing that people are going to put on the list is locating the tiles themselves. To even put them on the items that they may leave at home. But here we go. Now we're going from tiles to something that the Germans finally came around after many, 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 many years of discussions. It's cup holders, guys. Cup holders are back in the news. Ford is redesigning the cup holders for the 2017 Fusion. They're going to be repositioned. They're going to be bigger. They're going to have ambient lighting. They're going to hold more cups and bottles. Cup holders, what do you think?
Haven't we done this before? In terms of the cup holders.
No.
we've been here before.
All of this
years ago.
You're telling
all
me
that we've been here before.
You're So they're going to restart the cup holder wars.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Well, you know, more power to them. You know, I am not going to get excited about square cup holders, oval cup holders, heated cup holders, cool cup holders, you know, unless they come up with something that's totally new. I am not going to lose any sleep over this. That's now, my view.
I find it interesting that you say the Germans are doing this.
No, I'm saying the Germans were the ones that fought cup holders for years.
Yeah. And to me, it's like, where do you remember where you put your cup? Now, I admit somebody needs to smack some internal engineers on the head for their design and layout is where they put cup holders. Once you figure the ergonomics, you get behind the wheel and you're trying to drive, and where do I put my arm? I don't want to put it in the cup holder or the cup. Yeah, come on, you know, a little better thinking about the layout of the interior cabins would be appreciated. But
well, if you have a 2017 Fusion, you won't have that problem, Greg.
Yeah, I'll probably just put it on my lap and not care.
Solved that. They have solved that issue.
Yeah, unless it's a self-refilling cup holder that has a direct pipeline to the Red Winery, then I don't care.
Well, I put it right up there with the cooling glove compartments, things that we need to worry about.
You know?
Well, I heard the rumor that some of the very luxurious specialty vehicles are going to start coming out with cup holders in the back seat large enough to hold a scotch bottle.
Uh-oh. If you would have said beer, you would have gotten Russ's attention.
I would have been all over that.
You know what? If they renamed one of the slots a beer cooler, people would pay more attention and really be concerned. Speaking about concern, Greg, you touched on this when you're talking about what the Chinese are concerned with in terms of autonomous cars. In a J.D. Powers report, they found out that the older drivers are less likely to want to own an autonomous car because they just don't trust the technology.
That is no surprise.
Now that's a lot of people.
Yeah, but you know what? It ain't going to come. We won't, believe me, this group of guys right here is never going to see totally autonomous cars on the highway. We're not going to live to see it, I don't think.
I want to prove you wrong, Russ. I'm trying hard to prove you wrong.
You know, it's there are so many moving parts to make that happen. And there's so much. It's not just, you know, a couple of years ago, some of us were on the Nissan 360 where they showed all their products and everything they have in Europe and Asia and in the U.S., plus they brought out a couple of mules, autonomous driving mules that kind of showed where they were at the time. And they did some marvelous things. But, you know, that's on a contained track. That's not out in traffic. That's not out in the snow and the mud and the rain. That's not in the dark. That's in the daylight. That's not. There are so many things that have to happen. Not even to mention the bureaucratic nightmares of the regulations that the government has to come up with, and then how insurance companies are going to insure them, and who's going to be insured. It's just not going to happen. So I was spent a couple of days with some Honda folks this week, and we were talking about it, and basically their theory is 97, 98, 99% of what it takes for an autonomous car, we can be there. It's going to be that last 1% that's going to drag on and on and on and on, and it's got to be 100%. It can't be 96% or 97%. If all your cars are autonomous, it's got to be all that technology, everything's got to be in place.
I think the other side of it is also the cultural effect. When you talk about older drivers, folks in our generation are older, we grew up and your car was your freedom. You could go where you want, when you wanted, whatever road you wanted to take, or path you wanted to take. And there's something about the idea of turning over control of that vehicle to a computer to take you to the post office. Oh, yeah, by the way, I'm going to stop over here and get a sandwich. That, I think, is the bigger part, is that as the older we get, the less we want to give up control of that car because it represents our freedom. I can remember a few years ago when my dad, who was turning like in his mid-80s then, went to renew his driver's license, and he was resenting the fact that Tennessee at that time not only insisted that he have an eye test, but they wanted to check his eye-hand coordination and response time. The car represents freedom. And the ability to be able to point a car and drive it where you want to represents freedom. And a lot of folks are just not willing to give that up and trust, at least of that generation, are not willing to give it up and trust it to a computer. Now, younger drivers or younger users, they just see, oh, it's another appliance to get me from point A to point B. For them, the driving experience may not represent as much freedom. But every one of us on this panel could not wait until we turned 16 and ran down to the state trooper's barracks, wherever it was, Greensburg or Pittsburgh, wherever, to get your driver's license. It's not that way anymore.
I don't think, I'll get off of this as soon as I make this one comment. I don't think autonomous cars will give up your freedom. I think that's more along the line of ride sharing, where if an emergency or something comes up and you just want to run to the store, if you're ride sharing and didn't own a car, that might pose a problem. But I think autonomous cars, if you actually own the vehicle itself, it's not going to give up freedom. I would own and drive, well, and sit in an autonomous car. One of the things that you find right now in a lot of cars that's leading towards autonomous cars is what they call active cruise control, where you set the cruise control that adjusts the speed based on the car in front of you, whether somebody jumps in front of you or not, or whether they give a signal and merge over. And with lane detective, or what is it, lane departure warning, some cars will actually pull the car back into the steering lane, into the lane that you're in. So I think we're seeing some of that now. And I enjoy those features, so I don't think that I would be afraid of using or letting an autonomous car drive me around the city. And FCA and Google are partnering to take the Chrysler Pacifica and make those autonomous. They recently announced a partnership where you're going to have a big van. Well, it is a big van. It is a van. It's a Pacifica. It's a family vehicle, and they're looking to make those autonomous. So these things, this stuff
if
is
I could
moving right along. Go ahead, Frank.
Before you move on to something. It's two things. One, I agree with Russ. I don't think any of us are going to see autonomous cars, I mean, on the public streets in our lifetimes. And maybe my older children may not see it in theirs. I think you're looking at least a generation out, maybe two. And the other thing that I don't hear a lot of conversation about is we act really, when I say we, I'm talking about Americans. We act like we're the only game in town. They drive cars everywhere, and I could see autonomous cars on a national basis being implemented someplace else that's a whole lot smaller, you know, like a Sweden, like where Volvo is, or Germany, or Great Britain, where basically countries are the size of states. And once a system is implicated, because it's got to be uniform, something's got to be uniform, you know, to make all of them work, all of them follow, and this sort of stuff, I would think, you know, that in a generation and a half, that we will see an autonomous driving system, okay, implemented someplace else, because the technology is there. It's the application that's going to be the problem, I think.
I agree. Well, it looks like Nissan has decided to, let me backtrack a little bit, give you a little background on this. Nissan went to their ad agencies and said, hey, if you all don't come up with something that expresses Nissan, who we are now, that people can easily understand, we're going to get rid of you. So they literally put all these heads of ad agencies in a room, and they had to come up with a plan to better express what Nissan is and what Nissan stands for. So guess what Nissan stands for, folks? They're going to focus on safety. That's going to be what. Now, you tell me, that really separates you from all the other manufacturers, because I think every manufacturer is stressing safety.
Well, considering that Volvo made that their mantra since going back to the 60s, Nissan may be a little late to that party.
Yeah, but you know, there's a difference. There's a difference between saying, it's the old propaganda thing. If you repeat something often enough, eventually people will believe it. And that's kind of what Volvo did, which isn't to say they weren't safe cars, but they weren't all that much safer than some other cars on the road. And if you look at, it's really interesting, if you go to the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety, if you look at their IIHS, if you go to their website and you look at how cars are ranked and what their top safety picks, excuse me, and soft top safety pick plus cars are, Nissan's got as many as everybody else. Their new little Sentra is a top safety pick plus. Got top ratings in all the crash tests, the whole nine yards. There are Volvos that don't do that. So, I mean, Nissan has as much right, I guess, to make the claim as anybody else does. But I don't think that really separates them from the herd or gives them something they can really talk about. I mean, as Roosevelt said, everybody's kind of pretty much stepped up their game in terms of safety. I would think there's some other things they could probably
incorporate something like safety plus emotion or safety plus something else. Just, I mean, we all know the purchase of a vehicle is emotional. Boy, you'd think they'd add something besides safety. But then again, these are ad agencies and marketeers. And the marketing departments of auto industries have given us all the social media stuff in recent years, too. So don't get me started.
They don't know everything, in other words.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see what the ads and the commercials look like and see how they express safety differently than some of the other manufacturers are doing. Porsche is going to sell, listen to this, the shooting brake. It's a Panamera wagon. In essence, it's a hatchback. It's coming to the U.S. in 2018. And you know how we love hatchbacks. So probably $100,000+ Panamera shooting brake hatchback. Maybe it'll change people's opinion of a hatchback. What do you guys think?
I'll sell a few of them here in the United States. You know, the Touring, BMW Touring, and the Avant, and a number of other vehicles do okay, but the United States still is having that issue with what we perceive as a station wagon, right?
I just don't see it. I mean, it's not a volume mover for them. But then again, Porsche doesn't really care about volume in the terms of what Ford, Chrysler, General Motors, or Chrysler FCA, or even Hyundai and Kia care about. We've got one too. It's got a nice name. It's got some nice performance features. So we can play there. And it's ironic, I find that they're using that term when Audi introduced that term for a concept they showed off, 4 years ago in Detroit.
Well, Porsche is more concerned about profit per unit, not necessarily the number of units. It's maintaining a certain profit per unit, and they seem to be the world leader in profits per unit. So,
yeah, but you know, it's like the old gag about the kid with the lemonade stand, and he's sitting there selling glasses of lemonade, and they're marked $40 a glass, and somebody comes up and says, How are you going to make any money selling something for $40 a glass? And the kid says, I only have to sell one. So I guess there's some logic to that. But, you got to keep the lines moving. You got to keep the assembly lines moving. You got to keep cranking them out. So I don't know. We'll see. I like the Panamera itself. So maybe this will turn out okay.
Well, we were talking about hatchbacks. Would you own a Mercedes-Benz pickup truck?
No, and probably I wouldn't. No, and I wouldn't own a Bentley SUV either.
Well, there could be a Mercedes-Benz pickup truck coming to a dealer near you soon. So they're looking at building a Mercedes-Benz pickup truck.
I mean, Mercedes builds good trucks. We know that around the globe.
But the kicker is, it will be on a Nissan platform.
Oh, part of their joint venture?
Yes.
This could get interesting.
Now, I don't see Mercedes-Benz and Nissan being mentioned in the same sentence. If you do, one has to be considered an upgrade, or the other one has to be degrading to the other one. I don't see mentioning Mercedes and Nissan in the same sentence talking about a truck is going to help anything.
Is it what the Frontier, the next generation Frontier is built on?
I don't have all the details. It's just that they have, they're working on a program to bring to fruition a Mercedes-Benz truck.
Truck. They've been talking about sharing engine technology for a while. So, I mean, even if you took the Titan or an offshoot of the Titan platform, put a Mercedes-Benz style engine in it, that might be what they're coming up with, and make it a global vehicle for Mercedes, because the one thing that I did see in China that surprised me, very few pickup trucks, and folks there are constantly asking me about F-150s and Silverados, because that's the kind of vehicle that they're really looking for over there.
Well, that would never fit on a Chinese street, would it?
No, brother. Down the street, that's it. And no bicycles, nothing else.
It is kind of interesting when you look at Nissan making a pact with Cummins Diesel with their V8 diesel for the XD, Titan XD, and then now talking about this. I would almost think, Russ, you're right. They must be looking at more compact to put a, because Mercedes has a fabulous V6 diesel. We've seen that in a lot of their truck vehicles, commercial vehicles, so maybe that's what they're looking at.
I mean, I think we talked about this a few weeks ago, where a lot of the manufacturers are just trying to go deeper and deeper and deeper into what consumers want. And probably Porsche for a long time is the only manufacturer that said, hey, this is what we're going to produce. This is how we're going to produce it. And if you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't, you know. BMW had that kind of attitude many, many years ago, and then they started going into mass production of smaller cars to try and, as I call it, reach down to, you know, another segment of the marketplace. And I don't know whether this is going to work for Mercedes.
You know, do you guys remember John Rock, who ran Oldsmobile, and I think he ran GMC maybe for a while too, but I remember mostly for Oldsmobile. And I remember sitting at a dinner table with him one day, one evening, and, you know, we were talking about, well, is this going to work? Why are they doing that? You know, that doesn't seem like something that this car company would do. And he says, you know, when you just boil it down, what they do is throw a bunch of manure on the barn wall and see what sticks. And I was like, well, there you have it.
Sounds like Rock. I miss those personalities for those kinds of quotes. You know?
This one is for you, Ron, and I don't know whether you've seen it out there in California. If they haven't hit California yet, they won't last long. You can now get your gas pumped in your car at home, no matter where you are, whenever you want it, whether you're at home, your office. And there are quite a few, about four or five startups that are starting to do that. And in certain areas of the country, certain states, there's only so much gas you can have in a particular vehicle, like a truck or something like that. So in certain areas, you know, they've just made it where they can do it, but there seems to be a lot of concern with safety. Have you seen that out in California, and do you think it'll fly in California?
I personally have not seen it. I have heard those stories, but I haven't seen it. It'll be interesting to see, because number one, I don't know if you guys know, but well, you probably do because it spreads across the country. California a few years ago instituted a requirement that any kind of fuel can, gas can, has to have non-venting. So it's got a special nozzle on it that it's supposedly not going to spill and vent off to the into the universe. And funny thing, more people are spilling fuel all over themselves with these stupid nozzles than ever spilt before with just a regular old nozzle pour into your tank. So sometimes those kinds of things just kind of backfire. No pun intended.
Well, we're in on that note. Frank, I'm at 401. I know you got to go. I didn't mean to hold you that extra minute. So
Frank's got to go out and get a little sun.
Yeah. Don't forget that suntan lotion.
If you're gonna go out and play, make sure you put on your play shoes, Frankie.
Okay, folks. This is Roosevelt with Auto Network Reports, and as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. And I'll add, no texting while you're driving. Thanks for tuning in. See you next time.
Take care.
Adios. Bye, everybody.
Thank you guys. Appreciate it.